whilst I perfectly accept that, you know, we need to support early discharges from, for all these patients, and there may be several reasons for physiotherapy and other things, but there are also terminally ill patients that are being discharged, and there needs to be a package of care that supports them in a compassionate manner in the community. Thanks.
Any further questions or comments on the performance report? Okay. Thank you. The recommendation was simply to note that you've highlighted any areas that you wanted further clarification on. So, on with that, can I second her? Councillor Dorgan, thank you. That brings us on to item 10, which is our care home quality. Jean is now the AD responsible for all agent dependence and provider services. So, Amanda, are you going to start on this?
Yeah.
Or Jean's going to start?
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for your new badge, that'd be wonderful. Good evening, members. The purpose of this report is to update you on regarding the care home quality across the world. It's split into three areas. Current position in terms of the Care Quality Commission, the CQC, assessment status and comparable data, which is as of July 2022. The second part of the report is around an overview of how the quality of care home provision in Wirral is managed. And then third, but not lastly, the strategy to improve and manage the care within those markets. This is not a key decision, however, it does affect all wards. And the recommendations for you today is to note the content of this report. So I'll start with the first part of the report. By using validated data and information, I'll highlight some of the key points that are listed in 3.1 of your report in terms of the data and information on what that is telling us. The source of the information is from CQC, Liverpool City Region, and the Association of Directors of Adult Social Care Services. And you have got graphics in your appendices that make it more visual. As the total of 116 care homes in Wirral, 69 are rated good and 47 require improvements. None are outstanding, as illustrated in the diagram and Appendix A. When comparing that data across the city region to our nearest neighbours, Wirral is almost double in care homes that require improvement. But it's not all doom and gloom. There's nearly 60% of the care homes that have rated good, as illustrated in the diagram 2 and the appendices. And a large proportion of those care homes are in less affluent areas of Wirral. The other point that I'd like to note as part of this report is the comparable data of COVID before and pre, so 2020 compared to 2022. Unfortunately, when looking at the going to make those improvements, what difference are we going to make? Thank you, Madam.
Thanks, Jean. I think the most important thing there is to say that fundamentally we are absolutely dedicated and improvement quality is a priority for women. And that the delivery of poor services, it's not acceptable, we must improve. So what are we going to do about it? A couple of key areas there, which I'll briefly talk about. The provider assessment market management tool, PAMS, you've heard people talk about it. And this is an online assessment tool designed to support improvements required within the provisions. Now this tool is actually, it's set against the CQC principles, and basically what it is, it's a tool for providers to use to look at their service before CQC come in. As a member of my team who goes through it with them, they will look at the service, they'll identify areas that they need to improve in, and therefore they'll be able to implement those improvements, not only to benefit the residents of the home, but also to ensure when CQC come in, they're in a better position and understand what they need to do to improve their service, and therefore go from requires improvement or inadequate through to good. One of the other areas that we're doing as well is we're going to produce a clear and transparent policy and procedures. So what are we going to do about those areas that aren't good providers, that are not providing good service or are consistently providing poor quality services? So there'll be a clear procedure, transparent across all services, so that providers are aware of what we expect and what we are going to actually do in relation to any areas that we are concerned about. Furthermore, we're going to target, we've put there 33 care homes. These care homes that we've targeted at the moment, they're probably priority ones, and they're the ones that we're doing between now and the end of January. All of those care homes have been allocated a quality improvement practitioner. They're going to use this online tool with the providers. It's very much, I can't stress enough, it's done with the providers. It's really important that the providers understand their service and what they need to do to implement the changes. It's no good just telling them. They need to know, they know the people they're caring for, they need to know, they know the staff that they have got to work with, and they then, once they understand the improvements, it's for them to do and make those improvements. We do that with them as well. They've got best practice support from the staff from within the quality improvement team. So we prioritise the 31 care homes. Those are the ones that we see repeatedly being requires improvement. So these homes will, year after year, still be requires improvement. So we really need to see a shift in those homes. The inadequate homes, we see those drop off or fluctuate quite often, and the good homes, again, predominantly they stay good, a few may drop off. The ones we really need to focus on and to change the processes and the practice within those homes are those repeated requires improvement. They're just sort of coasting along at just about requires improvement. Not enough to have sanctions, but not good either. So they're the ones we're really going to focus on. After that, after the first, it was a quarter, we moved to the third, deal with more care homes in the first instance. We'll then use this tool, the PAMS assessment tool, across the whole market. And I know we're talking about care homes here today, but actually we're using this tool to go across the domiciliary care, the supported living care, and any extra care as well. So this tool is going to be rolled out across the whole market, the purpose being it's transparent and people can see what is expected of them, and we're there to support them to do that. Again, there we are doing this as part of the Liverpool City region, so we've got benchmarks across the area. That's really important when we've got the specialist homes, because as you'll know, it may be that those providers have got a home in on the Wirral, they've got one in Liverpool, or one in St Helens, and if we're not contract managing or monitoring their level of transparent, and the providers themselves can see when the assessment's done in partnership with them, the areas that need to improve. So it's not someone goes away in the dark room and goes, there's your report, this is what you need to improve. They know as they go through it what they need to improve, which is really key. Again, we'll just stress that collaboration between providers and the quality improvement team. Best practice, the quality improvement team are a really skilled group of individuals, and they work with NHS colleagues, they work with social care, they work across all sectors and have a vast knowledge in relation to what homes can do to improve the quality they've got. And there's no one size fits all, that's the thing about care homes. So it's really key that we do have that skilled bunch of individuals who actually can flex their knowledge and make it fit what each individual care home needs to do to improve and get that good rating. Again, effective and efficient use of resources. It would be no good, as I've said, if we went around telling people what was wrong with their service. This is about supporting them to understand what areas they need to improve to provide a better service for the people who reside with them. And finally on there, we've said about the synergy with the creation of 246 extra care facilities. Part of the process that we talked about earlier on is not accepting poor quality care. And we need an alternative to the residential model. We've already talked about how the domiciliary models are flexing up and down into residential. And the new provision of the extra care means that those poorer quality care homes who unfortunately have had to use or perhaps been reliant on in the past are no longer needed, and people can actually be supported in much better, higher quality facilities such as the extra care, and there's more of those coming on board.
In terms of the legal implications, it's around the court being in compliance.
what's the evidence from the GM, from the GM work, about how effective it was, or from all these other local authorities that are using it?
I haven't got the information on the apps. There is evidence to show, which is why lots of local authorities are now using it, is that it does benefit, and the number of good rated care homes does go up. However, the issue that we will always have is that with CQC, they changed models years ago by, and it actually takes over 12 months to get from being a required improvement home to a good home in relation to your CQC inspections, because they have a schedule of which if you are an inadequate home, they will come out within 6 months. If you're a required improvement, it goes for a year.